Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of A Homemade Life, Stories and Recipes from My Kitchen Table by Molly Wizenberg, narrated by Mia Barron.
Introduction. It started when I was a freshman in high school. We'd be sitting at the kitchen table, the three of us, eating dinner, when my father would lift his head from his plate and say it. You know, we eat better at home than most people do in restaurants. Sometimes, for good measure, he'd slap the table and let loose a long ooh of contentment. It didn't seem to matter what we were eating. It could have been some sliced tomatoes or a bowl of mashed potatoes or some fish that he'd fried in a pat of butter. At least every couple of weeks, he said it. To me, it sounded like tacky bragging, the kind of proud exaggeration that fathers specialize in. It's the suburban man's equivalent of ripping open his shirt and beating his chest with his fists. I would shrink into my chair, blushing hotly, the moment it crossed the threshold of his lips. I was mortified by the weird pleasure he took in our family meal. After a while, I could even sense it coming. I'd mouthed the words before he could say them. You know, we eat better at home than most people do in restaurants. But now, I'm old enough to admit that he was right. It's not that we knew how to cook especially well, or that we always ate food that was particularly good. There were hot dogs sometimes and cans of baked beans. Our garlic came in a jar, minced and ready, and our butter was known to go rancid. What was so satisfying, I think, was something else. It was the steady rhythm of meeting in the kitchen every night, sitting down at the table and sharing a meal. Dinner didn't come through a swinging door balanced on the arm of an anonymous waiter. It was something that we made together. We built our family that way, in the kitchen, 7 nights a week. We built a life for ourselves, together around that table. And although I couldn't admit it then, my father was showing me, in his pleasure and in his pride, how to live it, wholly, hungrily, loudly. When I walk into my kitchen today, I am not alone. Whether we know it or not, none of us is. We bring fathers and mothers and kitchen tables and every meal we have ever eaten. Food is never just food. It's also a way of getting at something else, who we are, who we have been, and who we want to be. When my father sat down at the dinner table, he saw more than what was on his plate. He saw his childhood as the son of two Polish immigrants, his youth in a working-class neighborhood in 1930s Toronto, his immigration to the U.S. after medical school, his troubled first marriage, his first 3 children, the beautiful woman in a brown faux fur mini dress who danced with him at a Christmas party, their move to Oklahoma, his successful private practice, his big house in the suburbs, and me, his 4th child, born when he was just shy of 50. No wonder he was proud. He made a good life for himself. He might as well have won the lottery for all his glee over those tomatoes or potatoes or fried fish. When I walk into my kitchen today, I bring all of this with me. Like most people who love to cook, I like the tangible things. I like the way the knife claps when it meets the cutting board. I like the haze of sweet air that hovers over a hotcake as it sits, cooling on the counter. I like the way a strip of orange peel looks on an empty plate. But what I like even more are the intangible things, the familiar voices that fall out of the folds of an old cookbook, or the scenes that replay like a film reel across my kitchen wall. When we fall in love with a certain dish, I think that's what we're often responding to, that something else behind the fork or the spoon, the familiar story that food tells. I grew up in the kitchen. When I was a baby, my mother would put me on a blanket on the kitchen floor, where I would bang around with pots and pans and spoons. I crashed my first dinner party at the age of 3, and I still remember it, mainly because my grand entrance consisted of falling, half asleep and holding a unicorn hand puppet, into a family friend's swimming pool. When I was old enough to reach the kitchen counter, My mother let me make what I called mixtures. Weird, what-would-this-taste-like concoctions made from such winning combinations as Diet Coke and cake flour, or sugar, garlic salt, and food coloring. As a kid, I loved to play the card game Old Maid, but I didn't call it by that name. I called it homemade, a word that made much more sense to me. Everything interesting, everything good seemed to happen when food was around. My family believes in cooking. It's what we do, where we put our money and our free time. I may have grown up in landlocked Oklahoma, but I ate my first lobster at age 6 when my father came home from an East Coast business trip with a cooler full of them. He upended it on the kitchen floor, spilling them onto the linoleum like giant spiders, and while they clattered around on their spindly legs, I stood on a chair and screamed. Then, of course, I had a taste of their sweet meat. That shut me right up. This is my family. My sister Lisa keeps a plot in a community garden where she grows her own asparagus, lettuce, and snap peas. She also makes a near-perfect scone and, for a while, wanted to open a chocolate shop. My brother Adam can whip up a terrific impromptu tomato sauce and, with only the slightest prompting, will tell you where to find the finest gelato from Italy to the eastern seaboard. My brother David has a degree from the Culinary Institute of America and owns a handful of restaurants in Washington, D.C. He can also roast a mean piece of beef. A recent Christmas in our clan consisted of 48 hours in the kitchen, a 25-pound turkey, 5 quarts of soup, 4 dozen scones, 3 gallons of boozed-up eggnog, 2 dozen biscuits, and a bushel of spinach, creamed. I learned to cook because it was a given. But I didn't learn in any sweet-at-the-apron-strings way. Neither of my grandmothers ever stood me on a chair and showed me how to make biscuits or beef stew. To tell you the truth, I hardly remember my grandmother's cooking. My father's mother, Dora, used to send us Jewish holiday cookies from her kitchen in Toronto, but she packed them in a cardboard shoebox, so by the time they arrived, they were only crumbs. I learned to cook because the kitchen was where things happened. No one told me to, but I hung around, and I was comfortable there. I learned how to handle a knife. I learned how to cook a string bean by eye until its color turned bright green. It was no big deal. I hardly even thought about it. By a sort of osmosis, I picked up a sense of comfort in the kitchen, and a hunger that lasted long past breakfast, lunch, and dinner. For a long time, I thought that this meant that I should be a chef. Interests came and interests went, but at the end of the day, I always wound up at the stove. It was the only place I really wanted to be. It seemed only natural then to try to make something of it. I can cook, I thought, and I like to cook, so maybe I should be a cook. I should try working in a restaurant kitchen, I decided. So one summer, the summer after my sophomore year of college, a friend set me up with an internship at a well-known vegetarian restaurant in San Francisco. I was a vegetarian at the time. It was one of those interests that came and went. I was assigned to the pantry station, prepping salads and plating desserts. I got to eat a lot of day-old ginger cake, which was pretty fun, and with the exception of the time the chef handed me an onion and asked me breezily, as though it were as obvious as brushing my teeth, to slice it as fine as an angel's eyelash, it went all right. But I didn't love it. I wasn't even sure I liked it. I never saw the faces of the people who ate what I had prepared. I never saw anything but my corner of the counter, actually. I didn't like the discontinuity between the kitchen and the dining room, between the procedure of cooking and the pleasure of eating. I didn't last long. I didn't leave college for cooking school. I got a degree in human biology and another in French and then another in anthropology. If I had stayed my course, I'd probably be standing in front of a class somewhere, talking about the concept of solidarité and social security in France. But then you wouldn't be reading this. All along, something kept calling me back to the table. Every time I opened my mouth, a story about food came out. In July of 2004, I decided that I had to listen. I left my PhD program with a master's degree instead. In an effort to make something of my madness, I started a blog called Orangette, a space where I could store all my recipes and the long-winded tales that spun from them. I named it for one of my favorite chocolate confections, a strip of candied orange peel dipped in dark chocolate, and started to fill it with my favorite people, places, and meals. I wanted a space to write about food. That's all, really. But what I got was something much better. I got an excuse for long afternoons at the stove and for tearing through bags of flour and sugar faster than should be allowed by state law. I got a place to tell my stories and a crowd of people who, much to my surprise, seemed eager to listen and share. What started as a lonely endeavor came to feel like a conversation, a place where like-minded people could swap recipes and dinner plans, a kind of trading post where cakes and chickpeas are perfectly valid currency. I'm not the only one, I learned, who believes that the kitchen and the food that comes from it is where everything begins. What started as a simple love for food grew to have a life of its own, and a life that, in turn, has changed mine. Now, of course, all this is not to say that my kitchen is full of sunshine and puppies and sweet-smelling flowers that never wilt. When I cook, there's often a lot of cursing. I've made soups that tasted like absolutely nothing, as though the flavors had miraculously united to form a perfect zero sum. I once charred a pork loin so thoroughly that it looked like a tree stump after a forest fire. I've eaten my fair share of peanut butter and jelly and $2 beans and rice from the taqueria down the street. But I still believe in paying attention to those meals, no matter how fast or frustrating. I believe in what they can show me about the place where I live, about the people around me, and about who I want to be. That, to me, is the meat of food. That's what feeds me, why I cook and why I write. That's why this book is called A Homemade Life. Because, in a sense, that's what we're building. You, me, all of us who like to stir and whisk, in the kitchen and at the table. In the simple acts of cooking and eating, we are creating and continuing the stories that are our lives. A place to start. I had meant to start with something more glamorous than potato salad. I always thought it would be good to begin with hors d'oeuvres, something appetizing and sexy, or maybe dessert, to cut right to the chase. A bowl of chunked potatoes in creamy dressing isn't any of those things. But when you grow up under the wing of someone who felt as strongly about potato salad as my father did, your priorities are special. Plus, you can tell a lot about someone by their potato salad. I like to think of it as the Rorschach test of foods. Potato salad means many things to many people. For some, it means mostly mayonnaise and starch. For others, it means oil and vinegar and fresh herbs. Some people add eggs, others swear by pickles. For Berg, as we called my father, a nickname my mother made up, a shortened version and inexplicable misspelling of our last name, it was something in between. Like his potato salad, he was hard to pin down. I guess the first thing to point out about his recipe is the presence of ranch dressing. I'm not sure how to make much sense of it, since Berg was, in all other cases, against bottled salad dressing. He was a staunch advocate for homemade, the house vinaigrette maker, in fact, with a dedicated jar and a complex system for creating his signature slurry of oil, vinegar, mustard, and herbs. But he was also full of contradictions. He was a doctor who never went to the doctor. A Republican on fiscal issues and a Democrat on social ones. He had a fat belly and pencil legs. He was, by the calendar, an old man. But he had an almost full head of black hair. He was a Francophile with terrible French. He liked foie gras on the one hand and ranch dressing on the other. And I can't really blame him. It tastes good. Then, of course, there were the caraway seeds. His recipe calls for 1 to 2 teaspoons worth. He liked them in almost everything. Whenever he bought sandwich bread, it was Jewish rye flecked with those tiny canoe-shaped seeds. He was the son of Polish Jews, so they were in his blood, I imagine, along with bagels and beet soup. But much to his mother's chagrin, that was about as Jewish as he got. He married 2 shiksas, one a Catholic, even, and raised non-religious children. I remember once, as a kid during the Gulf War, hearing one of my father's cousins in Toronto say something about Tel Aviv, worrying that it might come under missile attack. I'd never heard of Tel Aviv. I thought she had mispronounced TV and that our television was some sort of military target. I would hear scarcely more about Israel until I was in high school and took a world history class. And it would take my going away to college to learn what Passover was when I read parts of the Bible in a Western civilization course. I've always known, however, what a caraway seed was. Then there's mayonnaise. My father did not mess around when it came to mayonnaise. His potato salad called for 1 3/4 pounds of baby red potatoes and, to bind them, a ballsy 3/4 cup of mayonnaise, mixed, of course, with ranch dressing. If my math is correct, that works out to approximately 1 tablespoon of mayonnaise per small potato. You can't be timid when you're dealing with ratios like that. You have to be the type to go after life with your arms open and your teeth bared. That's the type Berg was. He could be pouty, of course, and a real huffer and puffer. His favorite weapon was the silent treatment, and he wielded it with impressive skill. But he had more love and more passion and more enthusiasm for pretty much everything than you and me combined. He loved being a doctor. He loved Dixieland jazz. He loved the old Alfa Romeo spider that sat in the driveway and never ran. He loved crossword puzzles, Dylan Thomas, and Gene Krupa banging on a drum kit on the stereo upstairs. He loved omelets and olives, murder mysteries and short stories, and a hideously ugly ceramic wild boar that sat on his bathroom counter. He loved his children, even while he forgot our birthdays, loved a cold beer on Saturday at noon, loved lamb shanks, smelly cheese, and my mother in high heels, loved mayonnaise, and me. He was the kind of person who could teach you a lot of important things, such as how to ride a bicycle or drive a stick shift, or that dill and potatoes were made for each other. He always put dill in his potato salad. We had a kitchen garden out back that he and my mother planted, thick with tomatoes and herbs. He would rub rosemary under the skin of roasting chickens and stir thyme into his corn chowder. He got such a kick out of that garden. He taught me to make pesto from the basil we grew there, using a recipe by James Beard, who I'm sure would have gotten a kick out of it too. When your father dies, especially if he is older, people like to say things such as, "He was so lucky. He lived a long, full life." It's hard to know what to say to that. What often comes to mind is, yes, you're right. He was 73, so I guess it was his time. But did you know him? Did you see how he was? He bought wine futures 7 months before he died. He saw patients the afternoon he was diagnosed. He wasn't finished. My father woke up each morning wanting that day. You could see it on his face. He was the one at the end of the table, laughing so hard that his round face split open like an overripe watermelon and his fillings shone darkly like seeds. He laughed so hard that he gagged a little and pulled out his handkerchief to wipe his mouth. He knew what he had, and he loved it. He could have taught me a lot of things. We'd hardly begun. But I have his recipe for potato salad. And when all else fails, it's a place to start. The baker in the family. While we're in the business of getting started, I'd like you to meet my mother, too. I think you'll like her. It's hard not to. For one thing, she's quite petite, barely over 5 feet tall. 5 feet and 3/4 inches, actually, is what she would tell you. When someone hugs her, she almost disappears, swallowed up in arms and fabric, like those impossibly tiny lamps and teacups you find in dollhouses. She inspires a lot of cooing, and though she's very assertive, people often want to pat her on the head. Luckily, she has a special trick for times like these, when a little height would come in handy. She can trot around in a pair of high heels as though they were bedroom slippers. Legend has it that she wore them straight through her pregnancy with me, with nary a swollen ankle to be seen. She may be eligible for the senior discount at the movie theater, but she's very much a fox. She also, incidentally, makes a fine pound cake, and between you and me, that's the clincher. My mother is the baker in the family. It's always been that way. She can make all manner of things, but in most cases, my father was the savory cook and my mother the sweet. He was the mad scientist, the Benjamin Franklin type, flying his kite in the proverbial lightning storm, while my mother is more of the pastry chef ilk, methodical and precise, with measuring cups and measuring spoons and much less mess. She loves recipes and she executes them exactly. That's a trait she passed down to me, along with a load of others for which I am very grateful. It's from my mother that I learned how to plan a menu, how to throw a dinner party, how to keep a check register, and how to spit cherry pits from the window of a moving car. She also taught me that, when in San Francisco and in need of a bathroom, all you have to do is walk commandingly into the stately Campton Place Hotel, as though you had legitimate business there, and cut through the lobby to the bathroom on the left. That's a skill that has come in handy more often than you might think. We weren't the type of family to have dessert every night, but when the occasion demanded it, my mother shook out her apron and got to work. She made Katherine Hepburn's famous brownies for my school bake sale, and for my birthday, a pink layer cake from a junior league cookbook, slathered with raspberry frosting. For dinner parties, she made apple crisp with walnuts and brown sugar, or nectarine cobbler with blueberries. I've never had her chocolate cheesecake, but I've heard about it. Namely, that she once, on a whim, set it atop the scale, and it weighed in at a terrifying 5 pounds. That's why I've never had it. She rarely made it again. My mother's annual holiday baking bonanza was, until it petered out a few years ago, the highlight of the season for a sizable fraction of Oklahoma City. The Saturday before Christmas, she and I would load up the back seat with cookie tins, each lined with red or green cellophane and filled with sweets, and we'd drive around town delivering them to the doorsteps of family friends. It's the closest I ever came to having a paper route. Then, of course, there was her blueberry raspberry pound cake, a perennial classic. It lay dormant for the bulk of each year, but awoke without fail in July to accompany us to picnics and barbecues. It's scented with kirsch and shot through with berries, and it is delicious. To me, it's what summer tastes like. My mother found the recipe in a magazine article about food processors, and it's been in her repertoire ever since. Most years, the cake made its seasonal debut at one of the outdoor jazz concerts at the Oklahoma City Museum of Art. This was back when my mother used to volunteer there, and when the museum was housed in the old Buttram Mansion. In the summers, the museum would host jazz concerts on its back lawn on Saturday nights, on the wide strip of grass that ran down to the rectangular reflecting pool and a marble statue of the Three Graces. Admission was free, and the better part of the neighborhood would come, toting blankets and picnic baskets. My parents had a wicker picnic basket that opened at the top like a present, and they'd fill it with cold roasted chicken, Berg's potato salad, and blanched green beans with vinaigrette, along with some sort of dessert, which, at least a couple of times each summer, was my mother's pound cake. While it was still light outside, we would unfold the blanket and eat dinner, and then, before dessert, I would be allowed to run around the grounds until dark. I usually got to invite a friend along, and we would torment the toads in the grass near the reflecting pool, or, when I was brave enough, climb trees. I hate splinters. Once, during the summer after first grade, my friend Jessica and I invited our mutual crush, Lucas, to come to a concert with us, and she tortured me by saying that she planned to take him up into one of the trees and kiss him. Much to my relief, she didn't. And anyway, we all drifted out of touch not long after. But 15 years later, when we were 22, I ran into Lucas while shopping with my mother in a grocery store in Tulsa and spent the next 3 years as his girlfriend. I am very proud of that, especially because I didn't have to get any splinters to make it happen. I know there are a million recipes out there for pound cake, and probably berry versions too, but as you can see, I consider this one to be very important. It accompanied me through some crucial times. It's also delicious, and it's my mother's, and more than any of that, it has the lightest, most delicate crumb I've ever seen on a pound cake. In fact, I'm tempted to call it a butter cake instead because the word pound is too heavy for what is actually going on here. It's rich, yes, but not too much so, and its crumb is fine and tender. The batter is very smooth, and folded gently around fragile berries and scented with fruity liqueur, it bakes up into the kind of cake that you can't help but want to eat outdoors, preferably on a picnic blanket with your mother. In Need of Calming. I was not an easy child. I guess you could say that I was fearful, but that alone doesn't adequately capture it. I was born with my hands over my ears, and I don't mean that metaphorically. Any sort of loud noise, thunder, vacuum cleaners, backfire from cars, made me cry as though on cue. But it wasn't only noise. I was also morbidly afraid of blood, needles, and people with any type of visible injury. Also, my head was enormous. I wound up in tears every time my mother tried to wedge it through a turtleneck. I was not a fun, happy-go-lucky kid, the kind who sticks her hand in the birthday cake and smears frosting all over her smocked dress. My parents, as you can imagine, were quite disappointed by this. On my first birthday, my mother carefully set the whole scene. Me in my high chair, enormous cake on the tray in front of me, camera poised and ready. But I wouldn't touch the frosting, not even with a fingertip. And on top of all that, I also hated bananas. Kids are supposed to love bananas. When all else fails, that, at least, is supposed to be easy. My parents did their best. To ease her mind, my mother once consulted a psychic. The psychic said that I was a new soul, that this was my first time on Earth, so quite naturally I was fearful. This didn't explain the turtleneck problem, but still, it was something. But new soul, old soul, if the me of 25 years ago could see what's in my freezer right now, she would scream. Lurking within its icy depths are no fewer than 6 ripe bananas, hard and frosty-skinned, lying in wait like small shriveled snakes. It's like a stockpile of tropical fruit terror. And what's more, I love it. Growing up really is great. I'm not exactly sure of the chain of events that led to my conversion, but I do know that it started with a banana nut bread made by Linda Pascal, the mother of my childhood friend Jennifer. The Pascals lived in the house diagonally behind ours, and our families became friendly when Jennifer and I, then 5 and 3, heard each other playing in our respective backyards. Not long after, our fathers built a gate through the fence, and we spent the next several years running back and forth from one house to the other, playing with my plastic toy ponies, staging elaborate lip-sync performances to Juice Newton's Angel of the Morning, and eating, as it would happen, her mother's banana bread. Such is Linda's talent with quick breads that not even I could resist. Her banana bread was a model of the species, moist, tender, and spotted with walnuts. It was soulful and persuasive, familiar and softly scented, like the nape of a baby's neck. I have thought of it often in the years since, wondering if it shouldn't be produced en masse, sold in drugstores, and fed to anyone in need of calming. Of course, it would take many doses of Linda's bread before I was solidly on board with bananas, and even today I am no great fan of eating them plain. But I find it very easy to tuck away baked goods made from them. Sometimes I buy bunches of bananas just to bring them home and let them go brown. There's something profoundly reassuring about having a bunch at the ready, ripe and speckled, and on the verge of stink. It's like hoarding gold bullion. Only this type of gold needs to be kept in the freezer or else it will start to rot. I love to bake with bananas. They make baked goods miraculously moist, with a sort of sweet, wholesome perfume that, I sometimes imagine, Betty Crocker herself might have worn. If I didn't watch myself, I would probably dump mashed bananas into anything that held still long enough to let me. I cannot have too much banana cake with chocolate ganache spread over the top, or too many banana-scented bran muffins. But my standby banana vehicle is the one that started me down the road in the first place, the tried and true, the humble loaf called banana bread. I love the classic banana-nut combination, just like Linda Pascal used to make. But I also like my banana bread with more exotic additions, like shredded coconut or dark rum. And my all-time favorite is a plucky variation involving chocolate and crystallized ginger. It's a formula I stumbled upon a few years ago with the help of my friend Kate. One Saturday morning, when Kate met up with her usual running buddy Glenn, he handed her a present. It was heavy and rectangular and wrapped in foil, and when she tore into it, she found a loaf of homemade banana bread flecked with chocolate chips and chewy ginger. Had I been Kate, I probably would have hidden it away and hoarded it, but lucky for us all, she is a better person. That night, she invited me to dinner, and after big bowls of mussels and a baguette, she whipped a carton of cream and served me a thick slice of the cake-like bread with a dollop on top. And then, bless her heart, she didn't even bat an eyelash when I ate three slices. In fact, she nearly matched me at 2.5 and may have outdone me in cream consumption. These days, I bake banana bread all the time, and I usually do it as Glenn did, with chocolate and ginger. It's homey but a little sophisticated, and it's almost impossible to stop eating. The flavors of banana and chocolate get along so well, and ginger makes them even better, cutting through their richness with its spicy heat. It's the kind of thing that begs to be cut into big, melty slices while the loaf is still hot. I'm still not sure how I feel about turtlenecks and thunder, but I'm willing to bet that, with enough banana bread, I could find a way to warm to them, too. The Whole Messy Decade. I was born in 1978. That means I lived a good portion of my formative years in the presence of mullets, crimped hair, and shoulder pads, hallmarks of that rollicking decade now known plainly as the 80s. I'm not sure it's good to admit that I was in any way present for such an era, but I'm willing to go out on a limb. Anyway, it's hard not to feel nostalgic about the 80s. If you think about it, mullets really were a smart, well-meaning invention. Anyone with long hair can tell you that it gets in your face sometimes. Mullets handily took care of this by cropping the front short while leaving the back alone. With a mullet, you got the best of both worlds, long hair without having to choke on it. I don't expect to convince anyone of the truth of this anytime soon, but I'm content to try. My mother did the 80s very well. She could work a pair of shoulder pads like no one else. You should have seen her in the periwinkle dress she wore to my sister Lisa's wedding, the one with the shoulder pads, the open back, and the enormous bow. She looked stunning, a little like royalty, really, like Princess Diana with braided brown hair and a better-looking husband. She was the fashion beacon of Oklahoma City. Our town may not have been Milan or Paris, but if you doubt me, you probably never met my mother. Like many other beacons of generations past, My mother dove headfirst into the trends of her time. Luckily, I do not mean cocaine or hair crimping or MTV. In my mother's case, I mean aerobics, with its perky wardrobe of pastel tights and leotards with matching belts, leg warmers, and terry cloth sweatbands. For a large part of my early childhood, my second home was a place called The Workout, an aerobics studio in a strip shopping center about 10 blocks from our house. My mother would suit up, pack me a bag of books and other diversions, and off we'd go for entire afternoons. Today, people often ask about the origins of my ability to remember 1980s dance songs, and I tell them that I owe it all to The Workout, to the thud of Reeboks reverberating off the studio mirrors. My mother was a natural at aerobics. She quickly came to be friendly with the instructors and even considered teaching her own classes. For my part, though I was only 4 or 5, I used my time at The Workout to do some serious thinking about my life. I decided that I wanted to be someone else. Namely, I wanted to be Sherry. She was one of the aerobics instructors. She had a soft voice and leotards in all sorts of bright colors, and her shiny brown hair was something out of a VO5 hot oil ad.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.